So, how did we get here? How did we get to this point in our timeline that we got Resident Evil Welcome to Raccoon City in the year 2021? Well, do you remember this bit from the last video? So, Chris comes up and I have him represented here as Sony. Some of you might not know, but my name is Ethan, and the character we're seeing FOV from is also named Ethan. So Chris shoots my wife, Resident Evil, and that's the joke. You see, it's so much funnier when I explain how the jokes work, don't you think? So that joke wasn't entirely accurate. Sony did produce this movie, but a lot of the finger pointing for this mess should be pointed at the people that own the actual movie rights for Resident Evil, Constantine Films. This production company purchased the film rights for Resident Evil in 1997. Constantine jumped on these film rights instantly. They bought these after the release of the original game. At one point, George Romero was even attached to direct a Resident Evil movie based on the first game. Romero had already directed a Resident Evil commercial for Capcom, and not to mention, he's the king of zombies in pop culture. This whole project fell through and was considered too expensive, too graphic, and too late to capitalize off the first game. They thought, since the sequel was just around the corner, it was going to be out of the zeitgeist to make an adaptation of the first game, which seems really silly to me. The Last of Us show that just came out released a decade after the game's release, and that show is massively popular, so I don't really understand the thought process behind not adapting the first game. So the Romero project fell apart, and then they got together with Paul Anderson, not the good one, the bad one, and a Resident Evil movie was made. And then another one came out, and another, and another, and another, and another. Then the Paul Anderson, this one, not this one, series of Resident Evil movies were over and done with. And then we got this. Before Welcome to Raccoon City was even in the works, they had a Resident Evil film in development that would have been produced by James Wan and was to be written by Greg Russo. This unmade Resident Evil movie was said to have drawn a tonal inspiration from Resident Evil 7 Biohazard. At one point, the story was considered to follow the story of Ethan and Mia Winters after the events of the seventh game. None of this was really coming together in the script phase, and the two eventually left the project. I would leave the project too if Constantine Films was trying to make me include time travel in my zombie horror movie. So, the reason we've had so many Resident Evil movies, and the reason a reboot went into development so fast after the previous series had ended, is because of the film rights. Often, when an intellectual property is sold, in this case, the rights to a live-action Resident Evil, then the person now holding those rights, Constantine Film, has to make a movie every so often or the rights will revert back to its original owner, that being Capcom. This whole rights issue can be seen as similar to Sony owning the rights to Spider-Man. To retain the Spider-Man rights, Sony must produce a Spider-Man movie every 5 years and 9 months or the rights will revert back to Marvel. 20th Century Fox had a similar deal revolving around the Fantastic Four, back when they actually owned it and had yet to be absorbed into the massive monopoly that is Disney. Now, I have no confirmation for this, but I have a strong inkling that Constantine Films has a similar contract for Resident Evil, and that's most likely why we got this movie so quickly. It would also explain why it's so cheap. Constantine Film just needed to put out a Resident Evil thing so that they could keep the rights. And it seems Capcom actually regrets making this deal back in the day, seeing how big Resident Evil is right now. Then we got Welcome to Raccoon City, and here we are now. Oh yeah, yeah, where were we? That's right, okay. Zombies that bark like dogs. Chris hears the gunfire from above, and then is also jump-scared by sneaky stealth zombies. I can't stress how bad the sound effects are on the creatures in this film. You've heard them all before. Goodbye, Knott Vickers, ouch. Character that nobody cared about. You will not be missed. We find real Vickers sitting in the helicopter waiting for the rest of Stars as he plays the game Snake on his Nokia. Okay, this is cute. This is a nod to Yon the Giant Snake from RE1, and if they couldn't include it, that's kind of a fun way to tease the fans. But give me my giant snake. I want to see a big old snake. I want to see Jill and or Chris fight a big snake. Unfortunately, Vickers is not able to beat his high score as yet another stealth zombie breaks through the glass and ruins his speedrun. Goodbye, real Vickers, character that nobody cared about. You will not be missed. Cutting back to Jill and Wesker, we find them exploring another room of the mansion. Wait a minute, how did they not hear the gunfire? We've seen the map of the quote-unquote mansion, and it's not that big. It's nowhere near the size of the Spencer Mansion from OGRE. They would definitely hear gunfire ringing through these hallways. I guess this version of Jill and Wesker are hard of hearing. Wesker sits down at a piano and begins to play Moonlight Sonata as he is told to from his Palm Pilot. This activates a secret passageway that leads deeper into the mansion. The frustrating thing about this piano scene is the missed potential. The piano puzzle is an iconic puzzle from Resident Evil. This scene could have been a lot better and would have lended itself to building up the characters of Jill and Wesker. In this adaptation of Resident Evil, Jill and Wesker have an implied romance that never really comes to fruition.
Nice to meet you, Leon Kennedy.
I wouldn't go there. She's only got eyes for the big fella.
Unfortunately, there's just not enough time to build up for the audience to care about either of these characters. Jill is one of the main characters from RE1 and is one of, if not the most iconic characters from the games. She has so little character development and screen time in this movie, and it's such a waste. I think the actress who plays Jill is a really good fit, but she isn't given anything to do besides being trigger happy. Now, the actress actually plays piano in real life and is very good at it. I'm totally stealing this idea from Susie the Sphere Hunter, who came up with this idea because I just think it's a really great idea.
The lady that plays Jill plays the piano in real life, like really, really well. You guys could have just had Wesker like sloppily playing that song, and then she's like, move aside, and then does it perfectly.
Oh, that would have been cute.
The scene writes itself.
This small rework of a scene could have been incredibly easy to do and would have added some much needed character work. Before the pair can head into the passage, infected real Vickers crashes his helicopter through the large window of the room, and another poorly done explosion goes off. We then cut back to Leon and Claire.
You're probably wondering what a guy like me is doing as a cop, right?
Well, unfortunately, Leon, I shouldn't have to wonder, but here we are. I rewatched this movie 5 times now, and I'm still wondering why you're a cop. This, my friends, is arguably the stupidest scene in this movie. So Leon goes down to the cells to investigate. Ben, what are you wearing?
His hair, whack. His gear, whack. His jewelry, whack. His foot stance, whack.
Leon then walks right up to the cell doors within arm's length of Ben. Ben grabs and holds onto Leon for a solid 13 seconds, and Leon doesn't do a single thing to help himself. He pulls Leon's gun off of him, and Leon doesn't seem all that bothered by this either.
Oh, let's open the goddamn door.
It's my gun.
Do it, go!
Okay. Here I go, okay. Jesus Christ.
Leon complains about his gun being stolen as if a child was upset that someone stole the last piece of pizza. While this is all going on, the other cellmate is slowly turning into a zombie, and Ben notices this. Ben also accepts that people are infected and being turned into weapons, so why doesn't Ben just shoot the cellmate that he knows is a zombie, or at least turning into one? Anyway, Leon gets this guy killed. Ben's throat wound has this horrendous fake blood on it. It looks so bad. The zombie that kills him also has an equally bad blood dripping effect on it. The door is open, Leon. Just go upstairs and shut the door. These things don't move fast. It's a zombie. What are you doing? Leon is saved once again at the last minute because he is absolutely helpless in this movie. Leon is still the lamest character. There's nothing this movie can do to try to make me like Leon or think he's cool in any way. He's just so boring and lame. And not lame in an endearing way. He's just a loser. Back to Jill and Wesker. Wesker picks up his Palm Pilot and lets this line slip.
Holy shit, she was telling the truth.
Truth about what?
Whoops. Wesker, being forced into a corner, reveals that he has been contacted by someone to collect the G-Virus and use it to help expose Umbrella. There is an attempt at an emotional betrayal scene, but
Come on, these are your buns!
I mean, Hannah John Kamen is doing her best job, but Tom Hopper...
Getting hold of whatever dirty secrets Umbrella are keeping down there and exposing them.
I mean, there's just nothing to work with. These characters don't have chemistry with each other, neither do the actors. Jill tries to convince Wesker to abandon his plan and go find the rest of Star's team before Wesker slowly draws his handgun and says,
I can't.
Just before moving Jill out of the way and shooting a sneaky stealth zombie that was behind her. I love when zombies try to jump scare characters. It just makes a lot of sense and it totally doesn't take me out of the movie in any way. Can we please stop doing this trope of a character thinking they're going to be shot and the other character doesn't say what they're doing and just fires past them to shoot something else? It's such a stupid trope used to raise drama when realistically, no one would do this.
Look out, he's got a gun!
And the makeup on this zombie looks really bad. I've seen better looking masks at Spirit Halloween.
I remember the first time I saw one, I didn't know it was a zombie in makeup. I just thought it was someone that didn't look very well. But it was like an early stage. Just looked like he was balding badly and had a very bad night the night before.
Irons, Claire, and Leon escape the RPD and make it to the old orphanage. Oh hey look, it's the Abomination. Leon walks down this long hallway and we get one of the only effective horror shots. The lights along the ceiling slowly move one by one. The movement is slowly coming towards Leon and it is incredibly effective as a rising tension. The tension builds and approaches Leon, and then he is jump scared by Lisa Trevor.
Fuck.
Chief Irons is then lifted from the floor by an unknown assailant. The camera pans up to hear him being feasted upon by some creature. The practical effects used on Chief Irons' dead body are actually really good and really gruesome and really not allowed to be shown on YouTube. This creature is revealed to be a Licker, another iconic creature from the Resident Evil franchise. The Licker pursues Claire and Leon down the halls and you get to see it in all of its CG glory. It actually doesn't look too bad. It looks better than I was actually expecting it to look like. The design is really spot on to how it looks in the games, so no complaints from me here. The CG model goes from looking not bad to bad fairly quickly. Lisa kills the Licker, saving Leon and Claire. Lisa gives Claire a clever key, hey, another reference, to a secret passage that will lead to the Spencer Mansion, and then they leave Lisa behind. Why would you leave her behind? Since this is the last we'll see of Lisa in this movie, I think it's a good time to go into the character in the games. Lisa Trevor is a character that was introduced in the Resident Evil remake in 2002. Lisa and her mother were experimented on by the Umbrella Corporation. She endured decades of experimentation and torment. All these years in the mansion, Lisa went mad and crafted a mask out of the people she had slain as her face began to fall off after years of experiments. In Welcome to Raccoon City, we don't really get any backstory, and Lisa is a good guy in this that helps the characters. The only insight into her backstory is when Claire finds a file of Umbrellas that says she was an experiment, but the audience never really gets to truly understand this version of Lisa Trevor. Besides the design of this character being somewhat similar to that of the games, there really isn't any part of this that works. Just another example of Roberts trying to add characters into an already bloated plot and ruining them in execution. In the scene with Chris, they try to have a creative light source where you only see what's happening when gunfire goes off, but it is so poorly done. It's basically that hallway scene from The Batman, but done from multiple incongruent angles. The camera in this is cutting to different angles, and it's difficult to focus on anything that's going on. Anyway, Jill rescues Chris and they go after Wesker. And that's it for the Spencer Mansion. Maybe 15 minutes in this location and it's over. Probably the most famous location from any Resident Evil, and it's over just like that. It resembles the Spencer Mansion in name only. Sure, it looks like the mansion from certain angles, but all of the coolness and tone of this location is drained away in place of this big, boring house. Two very frustrating things about the Spencer Mansion is how dark everything is. You can't really make out any of the details in the mansion, which means you can't appreciate the set design. The movie uses darkness as a cheat code to up the scary factor rather than doing anything actually scary. I know that a major reason for the darkness is to hide any seams in the cheap set and clear set extensions.
They gave us the actual blueprints of the mansion and the police station, so we built them to the spec of the game. Gave me shivers, like walking into the mansion or seeing the police station for the first time. I was like, oh my god, I'm actually here. I'm in the game, you know?
No, you're not. That is a staircase with a green box around it. If you play RE1 or 2, you'll notice the games aren't that dark. Sure, a good chunk of the games are dark, but there are also a lot of areas that feel kind of like a liminal space, which adds to the uneasy tone you feel when playing. The boring part of the mansion is how it's just a big house. Not only is it too small, there are no traps and there's only one puzzle. The point of the Spencer Mansion is to be a death trap that holds horrifying abominations of science and mechanized killing machines that the characters have to withstand. It was designed to be a way to test the BOWs that Umbrella had been developing. The best way to test those was to put them up against the elite STARS members and to see how they performed. But the explanation for the outbreak in this movie is that it was just a big accident. That just makes it way less interesting. Sure, an evil pharmaceutical company developing monsters in a haunted house is very dumb, but we've already established how goofy Resident Evil is.
No thanks, bro.
Claire and Leon find files of all the children that were experimented on, including Lisa Trevor. Claire is one of the only characters with a personal stake in this story. With what little she's given, Caius Galerio is doing a really good job.
You're experimenting on him. This is where they try to bring me.
So Birkin is down in the lab with his family, and Annette doesn't seem to have any knowledge of what he's been doing down here. This is a very large departure from the games, where Annette was working directly beside William on these experiments.
You're Umbrella too. You're telling me you weren't involved in this?
Yes. But we never meant for this to happen.
Okay, let me handle this.
We'll see about that.
I'm sorry for my lack of manners.
Now, listen carefully, my dear.
You guys are idiots.
I am not one to squander my investments.
I'm sorry, but I have my reasons.
I will take the liberty of choosing for you.
My goodness. Oh my.
I realize this moment may not be the most...
Stop it!
...convenient.
Go to hell! Stop it!
Prepare for unforeseen consequences.
So then Wesker gets shot by Jill because she thinks he's gonna shoot this little girl, I think, and now he's dead. Yeah, he's dead now. We bear witness to a hollow attempt at an emotional death with Wesker, and I feel nothing.
I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry. I wouldn't have pulled the trigger, kid.
Jill, Chris, and Sherry leave the room as Birkin awakens with the help of the G-virus that he injected himself with. These sound effects are incredibly lame and have been used in countless other films. I love this shot of Birkin, because the virus just made his ears huge. William Birkin then goes into a cliche evil villain monologue as he taunts Chris. He's acting the way Wesker should be acting.
How could you be so dumb when your sister's so smart?
I don't even need to say it, but I will. The VFX looks like garbage. This is something you could have pulled off relatively easy with a makeup prosthetic, and it looks like they used some makeup prosthetics, but they just covered it with all the CG crap, and it looks so bad. This version of Birkin is so much worse than the version from the games. In RE2, Birkin is a scientist that is just in way over his head. When you encounter the different stages of Birkin's infection, he's constantly struggling to maintain his sanity. It's very Jekyll and Hyde in that way. In Welcome to Raccoon City, he just loves being evil, I guess, and the performance is, at best, B-movie level acting. I know I said I wanted a Resident Evil movie to be silly and have fun, but the problem is, first of all, this is something Wesker should be doing, and second of all, the rest of the tone of the movie is not played up to be silly and kind of a dark comedy. It's got comedic moments that usually fall flat, and it's very much played straight. And then you just have this maniac come into set and start acting like this.
You know, I should have taken you and your sister down to the lab. You would have made excellent specimens.
I think there are a couple options you can take Resident Evil in. If you base it more off the older games, it can be a little more camp. It can be a bit Evil Dead 2.
Groovy.
But you look at the modern remakes of the games, and they're a bit darker, a little more played straight, but they still have silly moments. And I think a nice balance would be if the older games are Evil Dead, the modern games are The Mummy with Brendan Fraser, but with a hint more horror. I think that's the proper tone that should be taken if you're going to do a modern day iteration of Resident Evil inspired by the modern games. I think that's the tone you should be after. Chris shoots Birkin in the face and then they leave him there on the floor. Don't worry, he's dead. Promise. Leon gets the train running. You know, the rookie cop that doesn't know how to operate a pump action shotgun? Yeah, he can start a train. Oh, look, it's... Oh my god.
You, on the other hand, well... You're a pit of despair. Frank, you disgust me.
Birkin grabs Claire around the neck. Claire stabs Birkin in his CGI human face and I hate looking at it. And then throws Claire forward 10 feet for some reason. Just squish her, Birkin. What are you doing? Chris then walks towards the CG mess and fires his handgun at him. Hey, Chris, buddy. You know you can use a gun from a distance. That's kind of the whole reason they exist. They're not swords. You can just stand at one end of the train and shoot him.
If I were to come at you, it's all about how I... Faster, fire! Okay,
I got you again.
What if I zigzag like this?
Chris runs out of ammo and just stands there until...
You ugly fuck! Oh, shit!
What? First of all, where did you get it?
Found it in first class.
Well, to be honest, it actually does make sense. In all the games, you somehow come across a rocket launcher, so I'll give you a pass. Second of all, Chris is maybe 3 feet to the left of Birkin, and when this explosion goes off, it doesn't kill him, it just throws him back. Obviously, this is impossible. Chris should be an absolute smear on the side of this train. And Johannes, giving Leon the final kill on Birkin still doesn't make him cool. He was cooler and victorious. So Leon's supposed arc in this movie is he goes from lameness at the very beginning to coolness at the very end. And the ideal way to show this is going from lameness and a gradual build to where he's cool and fresh and ready for Resident Evil 4. But that's not what we got. We got this. Yeah, this doesn't look right. Anyway, Raccoon City goes... I'm so tired. I'm so tired. Oh, I'm in the end game. I'm at the final stretch. No, I'm so tired. I hate this fucking movie. Raccoon City goes boom, and so does this cow. This cow gets put out of its misery, but I am still here talking about this god-awful movie. This cow is the best character in the movie, by the way. Movie's over. It's done. The group of remaining survivors exit the train tunnel with their heads up, ready to take on a new adventure in the sequel that will definitely, totally, for real, gonna happen, because it definitely made enough money to get a sequel. Whew, I'm done. Wait a minute. Do you hear that? It sounds like... sequel bait.
We see Wesker alive when we thought he was dead, and we meet Ada Wong and realize she's been the person pulling the strings behind his sort of nefarious dealings. We see him, he's sort of blinded by the light, and she gives him some sunglasses, and he puts the sunglasses on, which is the iconic look of Wesker, and that's how we end the movie, and it's the beginning of Wesker as we know now.
You never told me your name.
Ada. My name is Ada Wong.
What the fuck? The Weekly Planet podcast has a saying slash award that they give out every year called the Game Is On Award.
For people who don't know, it's when a movie very, very, very transparently and very, just very forthrightly announces that they give us a little tease that is just going to be like...
They're like, get ready.
Get ready. The next thing is going to be
absolutely... loved this, but this, imagine what else.
That you've loved this movie so much that you are gonna love the sequel, which is gonna come out soon.
It's definitely
the franchise,
gonna happen.
The extended universe. It's definitely gonna happen.
Let the games begin.
This is awarded to a movie that has an ending or an end credit scene that sets up a future installment that will most likely never come out. The ending for Welcome to Raccoon City is a perfect nominee in my opinion. All of it is just incredible. The hilariously bad overacting, the character name drop that means nothing unless you played the games, and my personal favorite, the sunglasses that make Wesker feel better after putting them on.
One of the things I first asked Johannes who were talking about it was, am I going to be wearing the sunglasses through the movie? And he was like, no, I don't want, because it should feel raw, it should real. So the fact that Albert West could be walking around in sunglasses just doesn't make any sense.
So Wesker wears sunglasses in the first game because he's a douchebag and he thinks it makes him look cool. In the other games he's in, he uses them to hide his glowing kitty cat eyes, and because he's a douchebag.
But when something's happened to him later on in the movie that means he needs the sunglasses, that kind of sits within this world.
Like the other characters, Albert Wesker is butchered in this adaptation. In the games, he is a double agent that betrays the STARS members and was actually the one that lured them into the Spencer Mansion to test out the BOWs that he had a big part in creating. Wesker is the twist villain of the game, and he is hilariously pathetic.
And now the only existing sample is in your body. I want it. Now!
I know I rag on him a lot in these videos, but I genuinely adore this character. He is so endearingly lame and hilarious that I get giddy whenever I see him on screen. I don't think this version of Albert Wesker was well written, and Tom Hopper was just miscast in this role. Hopper is honestly a better fit to play Chris Redfield, or at the very least an older Chris. This man's arms are the size of my head, and they look highly capable of punching a boulder. So I sent my friend Cunning Links a screenshot of this movie and asked him to name the characters, and he is also a big fan of the Resident Evil games, and he thought that Tom Hopper was playing Chris. Go check out Links on Twitch and YouTube, he's great. The Good. I know I've really been tearing into this movie for the last two videos, but it's not all bad, which just makes it more frustrating because I will occasionally get little nuggets of potential that are just wasted. Without a doubt, the best thing about this movie is the musical score by Mark Corvin. Mark Corvin has worked on horror films from Robert Eggers, including The Witch and The Lighthouse. The score in Welcome to Raccoon City is very effective, and it feels like it could slot into any of the Resident Evil games and work. The orphanage sting they use throughout the film is ominous and effective at enhancing the film's tone that it's going for. My personal favorite track from the movie is The Train, and it feels appropriately Resident Evil. I also don't hate the cast. I definitely don't like most of them, but some of them are alright. Kaia Scodelario is the obvious standout, not only in terms of accuracy, but the performance. She's definitely slotted into the role as the main character of this story. She has a goal at the beginning of the story and has a personal reason to be a part of the main plotline. Some of the cinematography is fine. There are these particular two shots that are cool, and that's pretty much it. The Bad. The writing is very bad.
How could you be so dumb when your sister's so smart?
There are too many plots going on simultaneously and way too many characters that the audience have to try and connect with in such a short runtime. The decent cinematography has its promising moments, but it's let down by the poor editing choices and lackluster direction. The effects are terrible, in every sense of the word. The practical makeup effects used on the zombies in the beginning of the movie were fine, but as the runtime went on, the effects got a lot sloppier. Now, the VFX is a different story. It looks passable for a few frames, but more often than not, it just looks really bad. From the liquor, to the fake bullet squirts, to the mess that is Birkin, it's all a disaster. Here's a fun little fact. The VFX house that was used in this movie is named Mr. X. Doesn't that just feel like a slap in the face? There's a leaked photo from Welcome to Raccoon City that shows a behind-the-scenes look at a potential Mr. X makeup. Not sure if it's real, but it's definitely interesting. If you're going to attempt a Resident Evil 2 adaptation, you should probably keep one of the most recognizable enemies actually in the movie. And they seem to think it's feasible to just put references from the game in the movie and think that that's enough.
There are blue and green and red herbs, and anyone that played the game knows exactly what they're for. It was just so cool to see them, like, sitting on a shelf. They're not talked about directly, but they're there.
You can't sell the entire movie on nostalgia alone. It needs to actually be good. I don't care if there's a typewriter or an herb in the background. If the characters are bad, I don't care. This movie did not have the funding necessary for what they were trying to achieve, and it was needlessly complicated by combining these two stories. In part one, I said that this story was complicated, and a few people said that I was wrong, it's not complicated. I phrased that statement poorly, because I understand that the story of Resident Evil 1 is very simple. A group of cops go into a spooky monster mansion, and then they escape, and it blows up. Resident Evil 2 is slightly more complicated. Zombie apocalypse, espionage spy thriller, and science mayhem, and then the city blows up. What I meant by it being complicated was taking these two stories and Frankensteining them together made it way more complicated than it needed to be. You'll notice throughout this entire movie that it draws most of its visual design and inspiration from the Resident Evil 2 remake. Claire and Leon's costumes, the RPD, the front gate of the orphanage, and constant other visuals are ripped directly from that game. It's become very clear to me that the decision to adapt Resident Evil 2's story is due to its immense level of success. That's why so much of the movie's visuals are drawn from that game. I think the pitch for this movie was to make it more like the games that the fans loved. But I think someone was more interested in making Resident Evil 2 than following Resident Evil 1. For example, the costumes that the STARS members wear feel like an absolute afterthought compared to Claire and Leon's outfits. One of the main problems I pointed to in the previous video was that I was having a hard time telling some of these characters apart. And you know how the game tackled this idea? Color coding.
Discover the rainbow! Taste the rainbow!
Each of the characters have very distinctive colors that makes it easy to tell them apart. For example, Wesker usually wears dark blacks and dark blues. Chris always wears his iconic green vest. Barry Burton wears a bright red vest. Jill Valentine wears a very garish bright blue beret and big puffy shoulder pads. Vickers in the games, one of the characters I got confused earlier, wears a bright yellow vest. If you had just fully committed to these very bright and vibrant costumes, I wouldn't be having this problem. Jill, Chris, and Wesker really take a backseat through this narrative. And what a missed opportunity it is to not capitalize off of the iconic fixed camera angles from the original Resident Evil trilogy. If you're going to steal something from the games, at least steal something that makes sense and that would actually have an effect on the medium you're using to tell your story. I don't know if it was Johannes Roberts' idea or the producer's idea to combine the first and second game, but either way, it was the wrong decision. But that's the movie we have now, and I don't expect to see another Resident Evil movie for as long as Constantine Film can withstand putting out another one to replenish the rights. But until then, we wait. A lot of Resident Evil fans do like this movie, and that's okay. There is nothing wrong with liking this movie. A lot of them probably saw a passable movie that had visual references of fan service from the games and thought that that was enough. And that's okay. I'm sure seeing anything similar to the games gave a lot of people satisfaction after what we had to go through for the last 20 years. But I just didn't get any satisfaction, and I know a lot of other fans like me didn't either. And I think we as fans deserve a lot more from an adaptation. Because I think a great Resident Evil movie is possible. I think it'd be nice to give Resident Evil a break, and in a few years maybe giving another reboot a go, but this time a good one. I have ideas on how to adapt the Resident Evil games into a movie, and potentially into a franchise, but I'll save that video for another day. These videos have gone on for far too long, but maybe I'll make that video in the future if you're interested. Well, I'm gonna go play the Resident Evil 4 remake. Until next time, I cautiously look forward to a break from the Resident Evil adaptations.
No, this isn't happening! There's no reason for me to go on. What? What am I fighting for?
Well, we're done. That took a long time. So this whole video was supposed to be one video, and then it got really, really long, and I wanted to get it out in some form before Resident Evil 4 Remake came out, and in a way I did that. I put out part one, which wasn't the original plan, it was just gonna be one video, but we're done now, and it's very long. I started making this video in October of last year, I think. When I make another video this in-depth about a movie or a show or anything, I do not plan on it taking this long. This is my first real experience making something this big, so it took me a while to kind of find my footing on my style of how I wanted to make this video, but I'm really proud of how it turned out. I'm really happy with how it came out, and I hope you all really enjoyed it. I have two special shoutouts for this video. Special shout out to Cunning Links on Twitch or Beta Nero on YouTube. He helped me go over the script a lot and helped me kind of rework. He also supplied a lot of the footage of the older Resident Evil games, so greatly appreciate that. Go watch him on Twitch. He's probably streaming right now because he is every day. And go check out his YouTube channel where he usually puts a lot of his Twitch streams on there. He's great. And then also special shout out to Chance of Fire. He also helped me go over the video and kind of fine-tune it with some humor and whatnot. So he was a very big help. Shout out to both of these beautiful boys because I couldn't have done it without some help. I'm probably going to go stream some Resident Evil 4. So catch me on Twitch at itsgulif. And I will catch you next time. I got to go catch up on some movie stuff, make some smaller videos, and we'll get to it. So until next time, see ya.